If there is somebody. On various business constraints, time constraints. Anyway, so and not hesitate at all. Just but and drop the question.
It's been an audio issue, like you can't hear me properly. I hope you can hear me very well now. Do drop me a line if there's still a problem in hearing me. I hope you can hear me. This is okay. So my apologies. Okay, so this webinar is basically on five techniques in reducing scope. Okay, everybody's happy now. Okay, they can all hear me. So thank you very much. So going ahead, as I said, my apologies again on skipping the next month. So in this month of February, there'll be two webinars. So this is technically January 2020 webinar. So, okay, let's go ahead. So one rule only in this webinar, that is, you shall not stop, thou shall not stop questioning, question everything. So you have any query, whatever is there on your mind that is bothering you with your particular issue in your organization with regards to scoping or anything else in PCI DSS, just click on the question tab in go to webinar and type in a query and I will take it up. Okay, now there'll be we always have like dozens of queries and most of the time I cannot do each and every single one of them, but one thing I promise you, if I'm not able to answer anything at this time, my team, who's also in this webinar with me, they will be, what to say, they will ensure that I they sit on my head and get me to answer each and every one of them. It's not that I don't want to, but there's just simply so many things happening and I might miss it. Okay, just to give a heads up, we are now PCI QPA also, that is qualified pin assessor, in addition to PCI DSS assessor. So there are many things happening. Maybe in the upcoming sessions I can take up some webinar on pin encryption and stuff. So so stick around. Going ahead, okay, in the listing I can see many of my close friends and even clients who are there in this webinar, but just for the sake of the records, to put a face to the window, to the voice, this is me, Narendra Sahoo. I have my own company with Vista Infosec. I've been in this industry for like 25 years now, and you know, basically in InfoSec, and before even InfoSec came to the country, I was there in software development and stuff, then networks and InfoSec, and that's how it went. Now I've worked with some of the largest companies. Okay, enough about me. Let's move ahead. Now, we have our own YouTube channel, Vista InfoSec Official, and in the chat window, I have put down, I'm putting down my the link to my webinar. The reason is that there'll be, I'm not doing PCI DSS from the beginning aspect, and I'll not be you know, taking that from ground up per se. So there's a ton of information. There's a ton of information on my website. We've got maybe at least a dozen or so webinars, and you know, you can see the link in the chat window that I have posted now, and you can see all our webinars on PCI DSS over there. I've also now posted my the link of my YouTube channel. In case you would like to click on it again, you can go into playlist. There is an entire what to say, and there is an entire listing of yes, on various subjects. I hope you can see the link. Okay, I put it in the chat window. There's a ton of videos on PCI DSS, PCI DSS, GDPR, HIPAA, SOC 1, SOC 2. NIST standards, and FDA CFR Part 11. There are many such things that has been covered in even PCI DSS. You know, PCI DSS and 27001, PCI DSS, GDPR, scoping issues, segmentation, top 10 issues. You know, PCI DSS on the cloud, the wireless. There are so many. You know, achieving PCI DSS in 90 days. So these have been my top webinars on the channel, and you can look it up over there. And these are just to let you know what our company does. We are into compliance services, risk and security management. We are separate teams for this, for compliance and risk and security management. And of course, what gets us most of the contracts are tech advisory, where we actually help our PCI DSS customers, clients, to even implement PCI DSS, because PCI DSS is a very tech savvy standard. And just to let you know, we are not a products company, we are not a software company, so we are not there to sell you any licenses or hardware and software, but we do advise our clients on what all could be bought, then you can buy it whomsoever you want, you want, that is, and we are totally vendor and product neutral. So with that on the agenda, this is what was circulated to you, and we have added a couple of more points. I've added a couple of more points now for you. So why it's a hot topic, PCI scoping and segmentation for PCI DSS. Segmentation is something else that I've done. And you know, another pain areas of accurate data flow diagrams and mapping IT infrastructure, external PHY connections and external connections. And finally, is effective methods to reduce the scope and why it is very important. Okay. And so terminology, CD, as I'll be saying, it is card data environment. CHD is card holder data. SAD is sensitive authentication data. And account data, which is card holder data and or sensitive authentication data. So this is the PCI jargon, which is, again, I didn't make it up. This is how it is. Why is scoping and segmentation such a, you know, hot issue at all nowadays? That is, first, there are many interpretations of adequate network segmentation. Okay, before we start, let me make it very clear, which very few people know, is that network segmentation is not a mandate in PCI DSS. You can do it if you want, you can do it, you cannot do it if you, you know, you would not might want to do it. If you don't want to do it, it's not a mandate. You basically do segmentation to reduce your scope so that your cost of compliance comes down and your exposure in case of a breach comes down. So not all, as the point says, not all are the motivations are in the best interest of security. Now, we get dozens of queries, like we have at this time at least 20 odd PCI DSS assignments going on. If I take it across, and maybe 25 across the world that is happening. And not all of our motivations in the best interest. So what happens is that so many times we get queries from clients and they basically say, we have got one office in XYZ location and we want that to be covered in PCI DSS. So effectively they are saying that, okay, we have operations in 3-4 more locations, but just get this one X location certified. Now, FYI, selecting the scope is not your choice. This is not an ISO standard. This is PCI DSS, and selecting the scope is not even the auditor's choice. The scope has been mandated by the council, that is PCI council, and the scope is wherever there is card data is your scope. That's it. So you got maybe primary operations in one location, but there is three people sitting at one location, at a second location, and there's just one person sitting at a third location, which are where card data is being touched upon. So all three locations are in scope. You can't say there's only one person sitting there or two people sitting there. So I don't want to keep my increase my cost, just have this maximum people location in scope. You can't do that. That is that's what is meant. So not all the motivations are in the best interest of security, and improper scoping choices are contributing to compromises. So cardholder data is still the very desirable target for hackers. So if you compare how many banks have been compromised, have been hit with a bank heist, and how many card data compromises are happening on a daily basis across the world, you'll know what I'm talking about. Cardholder data is the most desirable targets for hackers. Then bad interpretation and motivations can lead to many, many areas, many issues. That is aggressive or accidental underscoping. What I mean by that is, in the zeal for making the network very lean, in the zeal for ensuring that data is controlled, audit happens in the right way, cost is controlled, being very aggressive, it can lead to accidental underscoping. And we have seen areas like I just had to cancel out an audit just last week, because what had happened was, once we started the audit, we came to know that the client had hit information. So there was another location in scope, and there were a couple of more processes in scope which were simply never flagged to us. So in such a case, what happens is that we've got no choice but to pause the audit, stop the audit, because the scope is not proper. It's not been integrated well in the entire audit charter, in the entire audit schedule. And then it can also lead to ineffective segmentation control, because simply speaking, you're not scoped it out. You can do ineffective segmentation. We'll get into this in more detail, don't worry. And this will lead to more disastrous consequences. It can also lead to overscoping. So by overscoping, it could be that because somebody has not studied the network diagram properly, or the data flow diagrams properly, or sitting with the clients to understand what applications are happening, what are the interplay between applications, and identifying the touch points, identifying the points of presence of card data in the enterprise, it can lead to even overscoping, in which case it is very well possible that they don't need to get that aggressive in that lenient in the scoping. They can get much more aggressive, which they didn't. So this can also lead to ineffective allocation, because as you know that there is a cost of compliance in PCI DSS. So in case you are overscoping it, you have limited resources, which could be a monitoring, which could be doing vulnerability assessment or pen testing or segmentation controls, or very important, again, I'm repeating, is monitoring. And this takes up valuable resource time, and you might not have enough people. So what will happen is the same resources are spread flat over a much larger scope, which can lead, this leads to ineffective allocation of security resources or suboptimal utilization of security resources. Okay, you might have noticed me that I started speaking slow. I got a couple of people who commented that I'm speaking very fast. So I just slowed down. So it happens sometimes I end up speaking a bit fast just to cover more content. Anyway, so this is one more webinar which is there on our channel, that is scoping and segmentation. I believe it's one of the most popular videos on our channel, with thousands of people have seen this and they have benefited from this. So this also covers our scoping and segmentation in a different tone, in a different level. You might want to even look that up. So coming back to the webinar, so what does in scope mean? In scope doesn't mean where an organization thinks that this is more important for me, or this application is more important for me, a particular application is not that important, or a particular application might get phased out and stuff like that. And so it basically applies to all the system units which are in touch with card data. And then the requirements, every PCI DSS requirement may not apply to an in-scope system. So there are like 280 odd controls. So not all are applicable to everything. It could be there are some controls which is very specific for, say, a firewall or a router. There are some controls which is very, very specific for wireless systems, for software development. So, or even for just, you know, logging and monitoring. So not all are applicable for everything. Now, controls to reduce, you know, there are some confusions with regards to controls to reduce applicability of certain PCI DSS requirements. For example, using a PA DSS certified application, you know, cuts down on the PCI DSS audit requirements or the compliance requirements. But again, there are some riders on that. So that's what there is the point of must be verified. And so what I mean by that is, in case, even if it is PA DSS validated, the implementation might not be as per the vendor. It might not be in sync with the vendor requirements. There could be some compromises that has happened at the utilization and or continual usage, which you know, renders most of the PA DSS which is done as useless. So then what does out of scope mean? So whatever is considered as untrusted is out of scope, and there is no security evaluation or validation of that out of scope system or network. But if you can somehow figure out that some out of scope system gets compromised, it can compromise the entire CDE, the card data environment. So that system should be actually in scope and not out of scope. So we'll come to this again. This is slightly tricky, and again, very few people are aware of this, and we get into discussions very, very regularly on this. So what determines scoping? What determines identification of people, process, and technology that interact with or could impact the security of cardholder data? Now, the second part is what people are not aware of. So many people feel that if a system is processing or transmitting or storing card data, which is, you know, storing, transmitting, or processing STP of card data, then it is in scope. Well, this is half truth. There is a second part to it. That is, systems that provide security to card data or systems that impact the CDE security are also a part of scope. For example, let me ask you that I asked to all the people for an antivirus server, is there any part of the card data going on my antivirus server? Yes or no? Try answering. You can click on the question tab and you can, you know, you can answer it. You can, what do you think? Can you, for antivirus, no card data goes through it, or the patch management server, no card data is transmitted, stored, or processed? Do those antivirus servers or patch management servers should be a part of security? Yes or no? What do you think? Come on, give me an answer. I'm not going to share your names. This just to make this session more interesting and to get your, you know, brain cells moving. So the answer is, it is a part of scope, even though the card data is not flowing through the antivirus and or patch system. The reason is The second, the last point that I've put, the fourth point, that is systems that impact card data environment is a part of the in-scope systems. So even the router switches, which are doing the segregation, or the perimeter firewall, all those things are a part of your card data environment in-scope systems. And again, it's technology, people, process, technology, PPT, all are considered as a part of scope. So it's not just my desktop servers, laptops, and databases and stuff. No, it's even the people who are part of scope. What processes are a part of scope? So it could be payment processing, it could be reconciliation, it could be fraud risk management, it could be clearance, settlement, uploading, whatever be the case. So they are all a part of your scoping in PCI DSS. So the first thing that we do when we start a PCI DSS assignment is to confirm the scope. If you are calling us in as your QSA, and I hope you do, then we would, the first thing that we'll be looking at is the scoping. What all is the applicability? Then we get into all the evidence requirements. It all depends on the scope. If you call us for consulting, that is to help you implement PCI DSS in an enterprise, still my first point would be scoping. Get your scoping done first and then move into anything else that might matter in the assignment. Okay. So systems located within the CD are, these are a few things. Okay, this is gets sometimes irritating for us. These three things on the scoping front. So let's assume there is one network, okay, one network VLAN or zone, and in that there is maybe 20 machines, 20 VMs or whatever, physical machines or whatever, and in that maybe of 20, maybe 8 are having something or the other to do with card data, and the other 12 have nothing to do with card data at all. But since they are in the same network, in the same, they're located in the CDE, they're a part of scope, irrespective of their functionality or the reason why they are in scope. You can't say that, okay, it's an MIS server, or it's a junk server, or it's a whatever gaming server, whatever you the heck you have. You can't say that there is no card data on it, so it's not a part of scope. If it is in that network, it's a part of scope. Let's assume there is a floor space, all right? Let's assume that, like, just I think today or yesterday I was at a client's place, same PCI audit in Toronto, and they have like 50 people sitting in the back office for processing, and of that 12 people were in were interacting or having something to do with card data for reconciliation and dispute management. The entire 50 people would be considered as a part of scope, because that entire location will then have to have all the physical security requirements and stuff like that. So it's not just from the technology perspective. Everything would be in scope if you're in that environment. So physical, unless there is a physical segmentation in place or a logical segmentation in place and or logical segmentation in place, the systems are in scope. So similarly, systems that connect to a systems to a system in the CDE are in scope, irrespective of the functionality or the reason they have connectivity to the CDE. Same thing. Let's assume there is a card data server or a card application, and there are, you got 200 people in the enterprise, and there are 50 people who have access to that application and are literally needing access for their various purposes and whatever, card data processing. But for the remainder 150 in that enterprise, let's assume that they have access to that application, but they simply are not having anything to do with it, in the sense they have, because of a misconfiguration or because of some business reason or because of some technical reasons, those people have access to that application, but they simply don't have any reason to log on to the application or do anything with it. They are still considered in scope. If you have access to it, you are in scope. Don't tell me what you're doing with it and not doing it. That'll come second. But the first thing is you are in scope. That's it. In a flat network, all the systems are in scope. Even if a single machine is storing, processing, or transmitting, account data, even if a single one is. If the network is flat, that means no segmentation. All, if you have 1,000 machines and only one machine is accessing card data, all the additional 999 machines would be in scope. This is how things work. Because if those non-CDE machines are compromised for whichever reason, their compromise can lead to the compromise of the card data system because they are in the same environment. Hence, they are in scope. There is no two ways about this. There is no way that you can say, we'll look at it in the next review cycle, or I don't want to consider it in scope. It's not really your choice. Please get that in your head. Scope is not your choice. It's neither the auditor's choice. The auditor is mandated by the council to ensure that he has scoped out the systems properly, to ensure, not to decide the scope. He is there to confirm the scope. So where do you start? First things first, as I said, analyze the DFD, that is data flow diagram. This is a good diagram that we sanitized for a particular client. Look at the way beautifully done. So a data flow diagram is basically for each process, you need to have this in your enterprise. So from where the data is originating, what are the points of presence of the data in the enterprise, how they're interacting, what is the data format, what encryption is using. And as you can see, the legend on the bottom left, so which basically describes what server is doing what and what is going on, what is the process happening at a particular point of presence in the enterprise. So all that is covered in a data flow diagram. Now, this is a mine of information if it is done properly. This has to be done not by IT. You have to get your business people or the application people who are running that application to do this. This will give you a good visibility into what sort of a data is flowing through the enterprise, through that particular process. Where is it originating? So what all servers are there? What all network interfaces? Now, how do we come to know the network interfaces? Go through your network design. So you extrapolate your data flow diagram with your network diagram, and you come to know what all data is flowing through where. So wherever the touch points are there, by default, it's a part of scope. Wherever the touch points are there, all which are able to touch those touch points are a part of scope. So very important that you get the right designs in place. Very important that you get the right diagrams in place. Very important that you get the right data flow diagrams in place. And a few more things as we'll go ahead, you'll see. It applies, as you've seen earlier, it includes even your network devices, servers, computer devices, and applications. Now, the first thing that you'll do on how the scoping part, as you've seen, go through the data flow diagram, go through the network diagram, identify all the system components. But again, this is indicative, your environment might be different. So all the systems providing security services, segmentation, or can impact the security, virtualization components, network components, servers, web applications, web servers, application servers, database, authentication, mail, proxy, NTP, domain, Active Directory, everything comes in this. Now, application, not just the web facing, but even internal, which is used by the internal people, are also a part of scope. It's not just the external facing application. So many times we get clients who are insisting, no, don't include this application because it's not network internet facing. That's not the criterion. Just because it is facing the internet, it is in scope. And in case it's not facing the internet, it's not in scope. There's not a criterion for deciding the scope. Now, proper scoping through reviews and thorough reviews are very critical. We spend so much time in just a walkthrough of the application, in just a walkthrough of the location, physical visits, sitting across a table with the business unit people and understanding what the scoping is and the sampling is. We come to know that part. Now, not scoping and identifying all potential systems may beware of this thing, that is not scoping and identifying potential system that may hold cardholder information. This can lead to critical and destructive hacks. The data flow mapping exercise, first thing that we do always, to identify all the points of storage, processing, and transmission of data in the enterprise. We'll go there again as you, to show you this again. This is extremely important. where all, from where all and how all the card data is flowing to the enterprise, whether it is stored, processed, or transmitted, has to come out from the data flow diagram. So it applies including network systems, encrypted cardholder. This is another point, that is encrypted cardholder data is still within scope. I wish I had saved a dollar every time somebody asked me this. That is, we have encrypted the cardholder data, so you know we don't need PCI DSS. Unless you have masked out the data or hashed out the data, you are in scope. If the data can be retrieved, you are in scope. So encrypted data is still within scope. So compliance scoping, as you saw earlier, network segmentation and storage is critical if you want to cut down on scope. Look at this thing: system, policies, procedures, people. You get a good idea over here. That is, in a policies, procedures, and scope, systems, which is in scope. People, from the people perspective, their security awareness, training, background checks become very integral part of PCI DSS for you. I hope you can see this. Okay, wait a minute. I'll just zoom this a bit. Please hang on. Okay, so you I hope this is a better view for you and you can see this much more cleaner and clearer. So all these areas are a part of your scope, all your firewall, home office, home systems where the data, even the home system where the data might be there, are a part of scope. Vulnerability scanners, IDS sensors, even the vulnerability scanner. So yes, even your Qualys boxes or Nessus boxes that are in your enterprise doing your vulnerability scanning is a part of the scope, even though there is no card data going there, because they are managing the security, or they are responsible for the security of the cardholder data. So in that case, they are a part of it. File integrity monitoring systems, everything is a part of it. The scope is, again, the PAN is not stored. Just the bottom line is that if you are not storing, processing, or transmitting cardholder data, then to your enterprise or to that process, card PCI DSS will do not apply. We start off in a scoping exercise with an inventory of all systems that store, process, or transmit cardholder data, as you saw earlier. Maintain in your asset inventory, maintain very clearly the system name, as we have seen earlier, as you mentioned. Ensure that you very clearly mention as to what is the cardholder data on each of those systems which is there. In case it is data at rest, DAR, the reason for the storage retention mechanism and the protection mechanism. This will help you immensely as you go ahead with the PCI DSS exercise or the audit. And technically speaking, these points have to be mentioned even in your ROC. Where is the cardholder data stored? It could be stored in both known and unknown locations on most networks. That is why PCI DSS requirements, I think it is 3.1, says that you need to have some sort of a process in place to identify all sort of structured and unstructured cardholder data in your enterprise. Now, what I mean by unstructured is your Word, Excel, PowerPoint, images, email files, text files. This is unstructured data. Structured data is for the databases. Like for most of the companies, like 90%, we have seen they have processes in place to identify card data in your databases, but there is no process in place to identify these Word, Excel, PowerPoint sort of files in your enterprise. So it is required for you to do a quarterly check for identifying this loose data or card data in the enterprise and decide whether you need to store this or get rid of it. that is required as far as PCI DSS 3.1 is concerned. Now, storing of tracked data, that is an absolute no-no. Absolute no-no. No matter what your excuse, unless you are issuer, you might have some reason to store and it might be allowed, but otherwise, no. You are definitely not required or not allowed under any circumstance, whether you are encrypting or not or something. The sensitive authentication data or the track data is not allowed, even if it is encrypted, password protected, scrambled, masked, whatever be the case, simply not allowed. Now, storing card track data, we just put this point down because we've had a few clients who are doing that. This is especially happening with a couple of clients which are actually printing cards, card data, which is printing credit cards, which are doing personalization of cards. We had some large merchant stores which are still using the swipe technologies, having the support for that, and ended up storing inadvertently the track data. And in cases, even the chip data is not allowed. And track data location, you can basically find them in databases, flat files, log files, debug files. So there's a lot of possibility of that happening. And systems that commonly store, as I said earlier, basically the merchants, the POS systems, POS servers, authorization servers, all are considered a part of scope. All are considered, can be considered by you to identify whether you've tracked data. The auditor is mandated to stop the audit because it's simply not allowed to have card data in your, this track data in your systems anywhere. Then the CVA, CVV2, CVV1, card data location, this is also considered sensitive authentication data, SAD, and you're not required to, you cannot be storing them. And for, we've got a couple of clients which basically said, okay, this, they've got a few clients who have, set up standing instructions. That is, every month debit this money from my, credit card or my debit card. For example, a bill payment where, there's an auto pay connected to it and stuff. So it happens. So in that case, what happens is that for a standing instruction, as it is called SI, CVV is not required. So if you're storing it, first of all, it is against the mandate of the council. You cannot be storing CVV1, CVV2, or CAV or whatever be the case. The pins cannot be stored. And secondly, is why do you need to store? Because it's simply not required if you have a standing instruction. No questions to ask while you are doing the scoping part. That is, now that you know where it is and how much it is stored, do you really need to store the data? Do you really need to store the data? Many companies just doing it for the heck of it. In the sense, we've seen a few ourselves. That is, there is no clarity, and nobody wants to bell the proverbial cat. So in that case, nobody wants to take the responsibility of how long the card data should be stored, or taking up the onus on that and taking a decision on that. So basically, it goes on a hold, or it just continues as is. So you need, where you need to store it, how long you need, that's where the data retention period comes into play, as you can find. In requirement 3 of PCI DSS, that you need to identify clearly what data is there, the retention period, and have a quarterly system of validating whether those retention timelines have been crossed, and to remove the data which has been which is going over your retention policies. And the scoping flowchart, that is from the start to end. Does the system store, process cardholder data? Yes, no. Yes, so then the CD is there. No, then does the system to identify whether it's in scope or not? And you can use this chart, make a note of it, or you can come back to the video later on and this chart will help you determine whether a particular process or person or technology is in scope of PCI DSS or not. And the next thing, does it provide segmentation? Yes, no. Yes, and it's a part of CDE segmentation. If no, then check, is the system segmented from the card data environment? So is it separated physically or logically using a firewall or and or kept separately? If no, it is a part of the card data. If yes, then does it provide security systems to the card data environment? If yes, it's part of the connected security requirements, so it's a part of scope. If no, then does a system have controlled access? Even controlled access is a part of scope. If no, then this, can the system affect the security of the card data environment? If yes, it's in scope. If not, it is out of scope. So you can ask the 6 questions to identify whether it is in scope or not. This is how we have categorized the scoping, summarized the card work. Category 1 devices are the systems directly touching the card data. Category 2 devices are systems that are providing services to the card data environment or controlling access to the card data environment, like Active Directory servers and all, Active Directory antivirus, patching systems, even vulnerability management systems, or the logging and monitoring systems, even your CCTV and stuff like that. So these are in your category 2 devices. And category 3 is systems which have got nothing to do with storage, processing, transmitting, or anything to do with controlling access or security of the card data. So we'll just touch upon network segmentation and move on. First, as I said, it involves the implementation of additional controls to separate systems with different security needs. So segregation of networks, same segmentation of networks, same thing. So there is a card data environment VLAN and a corporate VLAN. You need to have a firewall in between, and it should be systems should be in place to ensure that all clocks are synchronized. And you can read requirement number 1.2, which speaks about a firewall that denies all traffic from the untrusted network to the trusted network. All traffic. That is where all these Active Directories, email servers, antivirus servers, patch management servers are also considered a part of scope. So if there is any sort of a potential for traffic flow between one system and the other, when one system is a card data environment system, then both of them are in scope. Why segmentation? You do that to reduce the scope of PCI DSS, otherwise it becomes a flat network, and segmenting then reduces the cost of PCI DSS assessment also, because then the auditor will take less money from you if it is a segmented network. And the cost and difficulty of implementing and maintaining all the PCI DSS also comes down. The risk and organization also comes down. And without adequate network segmentation, the entire network, all the locations, the entire operations becomes a part of scope. So that phenomenally changes your cost of compliance in the enterprise. As I said earlier, it's not a PCI DSS requirement. You can do it using multiple areas, multiple technologies. It could be firewalls, routers with strong access control list, or any other technology that you can use to restrict access to a segment. You can use, so PCI DSS doesn't mandate how the segmentation should be done or what technology you should be using. The thing is that it should be isolated one to the other, and direct traffic should be prohibited. Now, whatever you use, whatever you call it, is your call. Now, acceptable forms of network segmentation. The second point, as you've seen, to be out of scope for PCI DSS, a system component must be properly isolated from the card data environment. If it is not isolated, with literally no traffic happening between the two, it is considered as in scope. Now, there are these, this is Mark. Mark is a wonderful, he's asked a wonderful question. I'm happy that somebody thought of it. His question is, he's written it pretty lengthy. Thank you, Mark, for this question. What he's saying is that, in essence, There is an Active Directory server which is used by card data environment systems, and there is another VLAN which also contains the non-card data environment systems, and both are accessing the same Active Directory. Now, since they are touching a card data environment system, the non-card data environment system should also be considered in scope, because A equal B equal C, therefore A equals C. Well, from the look of it, my friend, you do seem right, but that's not how it is. These come under shared services, whether it is those patching, antivirus, Active Directory, you know, even the firewalls and all comes under something called a shared services. In shared services, you know, it could be you know, servicing the non-card data environment with the right hand, and maybe the card data environment with the left hand, and nothing, and you know, the right doesn't know what the left is doing. If you can show that, in the shared devices can also be put in for this, can be shown as a process for doing the segmentation in the network. I'll give you a nice chart over here. You can do that. Can scope be reduced due to end-to-end segmentation? Yes. Did the assessor validate effectiveness of segmentation? If yes, the assessor documents in reports all the network segmentation in place. We have to actually check whether the, what ports are open from the card data environment to the non-card data environment. And scope can be limited to isolated areas that store, process, or transmit card data. If segmentation is not done, the entire network is in scope. Bottom line is to prevent out of scope segmentation. The bottom line is to prevent out of scope systems from being able to communicate with systems in the card data environment, or they are able to impact the security of the card data environment. So five simple tips to take it ahead to reducing scope. Quick fix reduction of scope. First thing, PCI DSS doesn't apply if max of first six and last four digits are used in your application. So for example, if your application is only having visibility to first six, you know, first six digits of your card data and the last four digits of the card data, nothing more than this, not even one digit. This first six, last four is mandated by the council, so not me. We actually have instances where entire processes and locations are pulled into scope because instead of last four, they took the last five. The application accepts the last five. So in that case, what happened? The entire thing comes in scope. So if you use the first six, last four, and the remainder digits are masked out or hashed, then those particular processes or applications need not be in scope, or systems need not be in scope. So if your database is only storing the first six and last four, and the rest of the digits are totally gone, cannot be retrieved, encryption, even if it is encrypted, it's still in scope. But if it is masked out or hashed, which means the data cannot be retrieved, so it is you can see that those systems are not in scope. Now the next thing is that get all the hard copies shredded or moved to an offsite outsourced providers. Most of the time this becomes a major issue during audits. That is, hard copies are not shredded, they are kept in cabinets, cupboards, and you know, printouts of reconciliation, printouts of dispute management, or even, you know, we do multiple merchants. Some of the largest merchants are our clients. So what happens is that we visit their backup location, and there we come to know that maybe 10 years back, they, or 7 years, 8 years back, they used to take cardholder data, you know, and print it on the counterfoil. You remember, like where you swipe the card, they give you a small printout where your you know, hopefully your, just your last four digits are printed. There are companies which print all the 16 digits. And they maintain those counterfoils in their backup location, so their entire backup location comes in scope. So what can happen is that just move all these hard copies to a third party, you know, provider. Oh man. Okay, somebody is asked, what do you mean by third party providers? Okay, we are not a reseller of all these. Oh man. Okay. This is Monica, and she's asked that question as to, this is a good question. What do you mean by a third party provider or an outsourced provider? See, typically speaking, there are companies which take away this hard copies and store it at their physical location, and they charge you maybe as per the area or as per the amount of paper that they're storing for you. So those locations are by default, they have not by default, I mean most of this or these offsite locations that they have PCI DSS. And then what you've done is you've effectively transferred the risk from you to somebody else. So okay, yes, I understand, Monica, you're asking me for examples. Let me give you an example. Again, we are not endorsing any company. As a company, you're totally neutral in our evaluation of products or whatever. We don't have any ties with anybody, but there are companies like Reuters is there. There is companies like Iron Mountain is there. There are so many small time players also. They just simply come in an armored vehicle, pick up your paper or your backup tapes and all that, and take up to the backup location, and they keep it in your cage or in your location that you selected for storing your card data, for storing your hard copies. The third thing is consolidate, move that one person. What I mean by that is we've had locations like there are so many big payment providers that we have certified in India and even overseas. And what happens is, okay, there is one location in Delhi where what was our original location, and that location everybody knows. So they all send their couriers over there. All the banks send the couriers over there. This guy is only there to receive the couriers and send it to their Mumbai office. Now, if this person is receiving this card data, he's in scope, and that location comes in scope. Better than that, somehow make arrangements to change the address and whichever inform all your banks and move them to that one location, or that one person, or that one process, small process, out of that one location, and reduce your scope. It will be a one-time cost for you to ship the person in the process, but you will really, really save on an immediate basis in the cost of compliance. Now, do not have unstructured data. This is extremely painful, man. This is, as I said earlier, many companies have clear visibility on what database, what tables, what rows have structured data, that is card data, in their systems, but they have no visibility. What if somebody has taken a backup of the data, like the database administrators, and stored on their machine, on their local machine for testing, and all those things is there? Or it could be like somebody received it on a flat file and stored it on their system. So do not have unstructured data in the premises, but that doesn't mean that don't run checks. You do need to run checks, but ensure nothing is found. And this is what I say, like if you just have one process which is an application which is just simply accepting the card data and forwarding it to the back-end payment service providers like a bill desk, so many companies are there. Better you outsource this entire payment gateway business to them. Again, I'm not suggesting any particular partner to work with. We are neutral in all those respects. But then you need not be having that web server, web application, database, even location in scope. That will really, really cut down on your timelines and money for this. A few popular misconceptions. No connectivity is allowed from or into the card data environment from outside. It is allowed, as I said earlier, with regards to shared services, but such as an Active Directory email and stuff like that. But system to system connectivity is really not allowed. So if there is some laptop, desktop which is sitting somewhere, and they are both communicating with each other, they are a part of scope directly. We have VLANs in place, so we have segmentation and my scope is contained. No, just having a VLAN in place doesn't mean that you have segmentation. The bottom line is what we have written here, that is inter-VLAN routing has to be forced through a firewall with adequate logging and monitoring. So if the routing and is not happening through a firewall which is located in the CDE, and that segmentation is not considered valid at all. It has to be flowing through a properly configured firewall which identifies what data and where. Now, many a time they also say we have put some XYZ product which eliminates all the PCI DSS requirements. Absolutely not possible. There are tools and technologies which suggest encryption or tokenization, which at best may reduce risk. I'm using the word at best, and also I'm saying may. It may reduce risk and may reduce applicability, but it is also possible that it increased because it's monitoring or because it's playing a part in the securing of the card data enterprise. Those systems then become part of the scope. So in that case, instead of reducing the scope, your scope has actually gone up. Now, host-based firewalls that you can use for getting a segmentation, the scoping part. Physical access controls, as I said earlier, just the firewall is not enough. Even the people needs to be separated. Processes needs to be separated. Logical access controls should be there, like role-based access control, location-based, and everything being monitored. And multi-factor authentication to on all in-scope systems. So any sort of remote access into an in-scope system should be via a multi-factor, MFA. Now reducing the admin privileges to the privileged few, actively monitoring for this again like the weakest part that you have seen. Actively monitoring of suspicious network or system behavior that could indicate an out-of-scope system attempting to gain access. That's where these SIEM, which is coming under requirement 10, is there required to identify that there is no data, that whether there is any data flowing between the non-card data environment and the card data environment. So thank you so much. I've gone overboard with my time, but thank you for being such a great audience. I didn't get time to take almost, let me see. Wow, I've taken almost 55 minutes, and there are like 22 questions pending. I'm so sorry I couldn't take it, but thank you so much. These are very, very valid. And you know what I'm doing now? You're coming up with a 5-minute series. Like, so many questions are there that people like you ask in these webinars. I'm unable to take it, but they are so interesting, so beautiful questions, but I cannot dedicate a whole webinar on it. But I still need to get the information out to you guys. So we'll be starting out with this 5-minute series, one question answered within 5 minutes. So put in your questions, write in your questions, and I will take it up. So thank you so much. And at the end of this webinar, as we end it, you'll be getting a survey. We put in a lot of time, energy, and money do this. Helping webinars get out this information out to you at no cost, but your words are very, very important for us. It could be critical, it could be positive, it could be suggestions for improvement, it could be suggestions for future webinars. Do drop it in for us. And these are our past webinars, which has happened. As you can see, 15 and 30 webinars is done. This is the 31st that happened now. This is a YouTube channel. Again, it's there in your listing also, in your chat window also. Please sign up so you'll get access, privileged, immediate access to my 5-minute videos, which will really, really be helpful. And it could be your questions also covered in the 5-minute videos. Our Facebook page, here also we keep on putting up a lot of content, blogs, articles, our LinkedIn page, where we keep putting up a lot of information. There is a healthy, lively discussion. To do follow our page also on that, and drop me a line. This is my email address, my contact details. So do drop me a line, and we are there for you, and I look forward to hearing from you. So thank you so much for your time, and have a wonderful, wonderful day ahead. Thank you again. Bye bye.